As I mentioned at the beginning of the meeting, I'm actually redoing a lesson. The reason for that is there was an individual who was interested in a Bible study, dispensationally considered, on Psalms chapter 23. And a number of years ago, we actually spent time looking at Psalms chapter 23, and we cannot find the recording. So that gives me an excuse to reteach the material, and that's okay. How many of you were here when we looked at Psalms 23? Good. So you're not going to hear anything you haven't even heard anyway, so that'll work out just fine. Psalms chapter 23, I bet you a number of you could probably quote Psalms 23. You don't have to indicate whether or not you have that capacity. Some are shaking their heads, yes. Psalms 23 is a very well-known psalm, and it's a very beautiful psalm, without a doubt. And many will memorize Psalms 23. They quote Psalms 23 as a source of comfort, for encouragement. And if you've been to as many funerals as I have been, you find that all too often Psalms 23 is actually quoted at funeral services. You know how at funerals they have that little card that will list a little bit of information on the deceased, date of birth, as well as the date of death. And sometimes the funeral homes will have a little verse, and a number of them will use Psalms chapter 23. And the reason for that is because Psalms 23 talks about, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. And often people interpret that to mean, you know, going or walking through death's valley. Some people assume that it's talking about the moment a believer dies, we walk through death's valley, and then we appear there in heaven with the Lord. And that isn't talking about walking through death's valley. There is a very specific meaning when one is talking about walking through the shadow of death. So I certainly don't intend to shatter your emotional attachment to Psalms 23. If you do have some sentimental value and if it means that much to you, believe me, it is a precious psalm. But we're going to unplug it. Tonight we're going to look at Psalms 23 unplugged and look at the dispensational doctrinal meaning of Psalms 23. Because, and I'm going to say this, I hope I don't offend anybody, but it is not written to you or to me today in the dispensation of the grace of God. Now, should that shatter your whole life? If you need comfort, if you need encouragement, there is specific doctrine that has been written for us today, and guess where it's found? The epistles of the Apostle Paul, okay? So, does the little flock have right to passages that will give them comfort and encouragement? Sure. Well, so to the body of Christ. We too have specific passages that will comfort and encourage us, okay? So, again, I'm not trying to shatter anybody's faith by dismantling what you might believe about Psalms 23, but my purpose is to bring great clarity to what that passage is actually saying, okay? It's a short psalm. Like I said, some of you probably know it by heart, but let's read it. Psalms 23, beginning at verse 1, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me besides the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." Our Father, we do thank you for your word. And Father, as we come to it now with quiet hearts and hungry spirits, may we know exactly the purpose and intent that you have for this particular psalm. May we appreciate its beauty. May we value it as much as you value it. And yet may we be careful as we rightly divide the word of truth and understand its proper dispensational context. We pray that our time together around your word would be profitable and meaningful. And of course, we ask in Christ Jesus' name, amen. Behind me, I have some chicken scratch, okay? And some of you in the back may not be able to ascertain what exactly I've scribbled up here. But if we're going to understand Psalms chapter 23, it certainly is important to understand the wider context, okay? First of all, we know, and we're not going to go into all of the gory details, we know that the book of Psalms is in that particular section of the Old Testament that compose or compromises the books of Job through Song of Solomon. Oftentimes, they're referred to as the poetic scriptures. I know Brother Richard, some time ago, just a few weeks back, as he has been introducing, or he was introducing the minor prophets, he now is in the book of Hosea, and he already identified the historic books of the Old Testament, the heart books of the Old Testament, and then there are the hope books of the Old Testament. The heart books of the Old Testament are five, Job through Song of Solomon. They were written for the purpose of preparing the little flock for this future period of time known as the tribulational period. And that's quite important to understand. So, number one, we know where the book of Psalms is found. The book of Psalms is divided into five books. And you'll find that, depending on your publisher or your, maybe in your edition, but most everybody's translation, certainly the one that I have, the book of Psalms is divided into five books, okay? Book number one covers chapters 1 through chapter 41. That's the first book in the book of Psalms. Every one of those five books has what are called core chapters. Now, the first book of the book of Psalms, chapters 1 through 41, has core chapters, chapters 22, and this is the one we're interested in, chapter 23, and then chapter 24, okay? So what I've drawn out is simply just kind of a general context, the heart books. We have Psalms, we're looking at the first book, and we're focusing in on those core chapters, specifically chapter 23. Now, why is that going to help us understand what's happening in Psalms 23? Well, as we look, for example, at Psalms 22, we know where we are on the timeline. Go to chapter 22 and notice there verse 1. Psalms chapter 22 and notice there in verse 1, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Now, immediately, we know what this particular chapter is dealing with, correct? Who cried, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? And by the way, just can I make just a real quick little side note here? I understand Bill O'Reilly wrote a book recently called Killing Jesus. Is that right? Killing Jesus. And evidently, a couple of weeks ago, he was on one of these talk shows, one of these Sunday morning programs, and they were interviewing Bill O'Reilly. And Bill O'Reilly, he insists that what he is doing is presenting an historic narrative about Jesus Christ. And the sources for his material is history, okay? He actually made the statement that when Jesus was hanging on the cross, he didn't cry, he didn't shout, he didn't make any noise. Now, wait a minute. And the reason is because if you're being crucified, the weight of your body prevents you from breathing, and supposedly you don't have the capacity to cry or to shout out in any kind of a loud voice. Now, and by the way, does it matter what historical books he may have referred to come to that conclusion? Because, number one, as we read, look at verse 1. My God, why hast thou forsaken me? Why art thou so far from helping me? And from the words of my, what? Roaring? I mean, doesn't that kind of indicate that verse 2, oh my God, I cry in the daytime. Listen, when the Lord Jesus Christ this passage describes the Lord Jesus Christ as roaring. It was loud enough for the audience to hear it. It was loud enough for the soldiers to hear it. So my point is just this. The verse describes what the Lord Jesus Christ is saying while he's hanging on the cross of Calvary. So here in chapter 22, especially verses 1, right on down to verse 21, we have the Lord Jesus Christ hanging on that cross, and we have recorded in God's Word what Jesus Christ is thinking and what the Lord Jesus Christ is actually communicating. So chapter 22 sets the cross on that timeline. It is the day of his crucifixion. And let's just go over to chapter 24. Well, I'll tell you what, chapter 22 again. Drop down chapter 22 and verse 22, okay? 22, 22. I will declare thy name unto my brethren in the midst of the congregation, will I praise thee. So the Lord Jesus Christ, he's crucified, first 21 verses. By verse 22, guess what we're reading? We're reading about his resurrection, okay? Look there at verse 22 again. I will declare thy name unto my brethren. In the midst of the congregation will I praise thee. Keep your finger here. Go to Hebrews chapter 2. If we go to Hebrews, now this is important, because when we're in the book of Psalms, we go from Psalms 22 to the cross, right to the book of Hebrews, on that timeline, if you will, in Hebrews chapter 2, and notice there, verse 11, okay? Hebrews chapter 2, verse 11. Notice, for both he that sanctifieth and they who are sanctified are all of one, for which cause he is not ashamed to call them brethren, saying, I will declare thy name unto my brethren. In the midst of the church will I sing praise unto thee. So what we have in Psalms 22 is the Lord Jesus Christ after his death, after his burial, we now have him making a declaration by way of resurrection. And that's why now Hebrews is picking up where the Lord Jesus kind of is left off there in Psalms 22. Does that make any sense? This is the point I'm trying to make here. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, we have the historic ministry of the Lord Jesus Christ. He's rejected by the nation of Israel, and he's crucified by wicked hands, and he's put to death. And then we have him making some declaration about he's not ashamed to proclaim his brethren. He's not ashamed to call his brethren his brethren, and he makes a reference to the church. Going back to Psalms 22, when we go back to Psalms 22, look there at verse 25. Psalms 22, verse 25. My praise shall be of thee in the great congregation. I will pay my vows before them that fear me. The meek shall eat and be satisfied. Verse 27, all the ends of the world shall remember and turn unto the Lord. Verse 28, for the kingdom is the Lord's, and he is the governor among the nations. So Jesus Christ, just like Acts chapter 2, Peter, he says, wait a minute, death couldn't hold him. So why did the Father raise up the Lord Jesus Christ? He raised up the Lord Jesus Christ to occupy the throne of David. And Psalms 22 ends by this great declaration regarding the issue of the kingdom. Because the Lord Jesus, obviously, he has to be raised up from the dead if he's going to reign in a kingdom. So we have a feel for chapter 22, all right? And then, of course, if we're in chapter 22, look there at verse 30. A seed shall serve him, it shall be accounted to the Lord for a generation. They shall come and shall declare his righteousness unto a people that shall be born, that he hath done this. So now there's some language about a born again nation. The issue of a seed, the issue of a generation, listen, they may have put Jesus Christ to death, but that's not going to stop the purpose that God has in establishing His Son as the governor and as a king in the kingdom, and there will be a specific generation that will be born again into that kingdom. So that's Psalms 22, and you know, we can go over there to Hebrews, and we see some information there in Hebrews that is talked about in Psalms 22. So on the timeline, we're there at the crucifixion, we see the resurrection. Hey, now we're over here in the book of Hebrews. And then, of course, in the prophetic timeline, we have this section from Hebrews through Revelation, and that Jewish section of the Bible, Hebrews through Revelation, is going to deal with that period of the 70th week of Daniel. It culminates with the second coming of Jesus Christ, that 1,000-year reign on the earth, and then ultimately the New Jerusalem, and then the everlasting kingdom. Psalms 24, let's just jump over to Psalms 24 very quickly, because when we go to Psalms 24, we find the focus is quite different. And by the way, in Psalms 23, if you notice in verse 1, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. Verse 2, He maketh me, He leadeth me. Verse 3, He restoreth my soul. Verse 4, yea, though I walk, I will fear no evil. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Verse 5, thou preparest a table before me. Verse 6, surely goodness and mercy shall follow me. You see, this is the remnant's perspective on what the Lord is doing. Now, 23 comes after 22. But now look at chapter 24. Chapter 24, the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, the world and they that dwell therein. For He hath founded it upon the seas and established it upon the floods. Now, what do you think about when you read verses 1 and 2? The earth is the Lord's. Verse 2, He founded it upon the seas. What part of the Bible do you think about? Genesis chapter 1? Well, why would these verses kind of use language similar to Genesis chapter 1? What was God's ultimate purpose in creating not only the heaven and the earth, but what was God's ultimate purpose in restoration, restoring the earth to live there? But there's a problem beginning in Genesis chapter. You see what Psalms 24 now is? The entire perspective changes. 23, after the cross, hey, He's going to do something for me. But now 24 has a different view. Look at verse 3. Who shall ascend into the hill of the Lord? Or who shall stand in His holy place? The answer, by the way, is going to be Messiah. Verse 4, He that hath clean hands and a pure heart, who hath not lifted up his soul. Verse 5, He shall receive the blessing of the Lord. Verse 6, this is the generation of them that seek Him, that seek thy face. In other words, do you understand? We go from the me, I, mine, to who, He, who's gonna. And what we have in 24 now, notice there in verse 7, lift up your heads, O ye gates, and be ye lift up, ye everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle. What we find in chapter 24 is the right that this King possesses, because He now has conquered the enemies of his generation, verse 6. This is the generation of them that seek him. What we have is a description of that second advent, the second coming, when the Lord Jesus returns, and the book of Revelation obviously provides all of the glorious details where he does come in victory. He is going to conquer the enemies of Almighty God. He's going to conquer the enemies of Israel. He's going to conquer. And because of that, verse 9, lift up your heads, O ye gates, even lift them up, ye everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord of hosts. He is the King of glory, Selah. So think about this. We have those core chapters, 22, 23, 24, making up that first book there. And so if 22 deals with the cross, ends with the resurrection, causes the reader to go over here in the Jewish epistles, if you will, chapter 24 concentrates on that literal coming of the mighty conqueror in light of the very purpose of creation. Is there something missing between 22 and 24? Well, the 70th week of Daniel. This is all I'm going a long way to get to it. Psalms 23 has its immediate dispensational context in the tribulational period. For people to use it today as some sort of a devotional because it brings comfort is not appropriate. In fact, as we look at we're not going to look at all the details. We can't do that tonight. But do you understand where it fits in the grand scheme of things? We have the general context. We're now going to look at the immediate context. Psalms 23 is information that provides comfort and encouragement for that believer who is literally witnessing the outbreak of wrath for that seven-year tribulational period. In fact, we can divide chapter 23 like this. Verses 1 through verse 3 will actually cover the first half of the tribulational period. Verse 4 now begins to deal with the latter half, or that second half, that remaining 3.5 year period there of the tribulational period. Verse 5 is actually a description of what that little flock will enjoy when the Lord Jesus literally comes back and touches down on planet Earth. And then verse 6 is actually the hope that the remnant has as they enter into the millennial kingdom. 24 kind of repeats the narrative just a little bit. It sort of loops back just a little bit, but not a whole lot. So the first verses in 23, first half of the week. There's verse 4, the last half of the week. Verse 5 is at the very end of the 70th week. And then verse 6 is a transition into that thousand-year millennial reign of Jesus Christ on the earth. That's the dispensational context of Psalms chapter 23. And if we recognize that, we now can look at Psalms 23, not demand that it apply to you or that it applies to me. In fact, it's pretty difficult to take these verses and try to make them apply to you. Have you walked through the valley of the shadow of death? Now, first of all, none of you have. And if you take it to mean what most people mean, we would be at a funeral right now because it's used to mean when one walks through, they go through this so-called death, the death process. It's not talking about someone going through the death process. The Bible uses language to describe exactly what's happening to that believing remnant. Now, one other thing that we want to look at by way of understanding Psalms 23, we learn right at the first verse about one of the Jehovah names, okay? There are in the Bible a number of Jehovah titles, okay? And I'm not going to get real technical, okay? You know, there's a bit of discussion. We use the expression Jehovah compound names. What exactly does that mean? There are Jehovah names. There's actually about 40 Jehovah names, okay? There are some Jehovah, very specific Jehovah titles. There are three that stand out like no other, okay? But when we examine Psalms 23, there is one Jehovah title, Jehovah Rohi, and then there are six Jehovah functions that are being dealt with in chapter 23. They're not necessarily Jehovah titles, but they are descriptive of the provisions that Jehovah promises his little flock during the tribulational period so that they can endure, because they will endure, okay? So we remove ourselves from Psalms 23, keep it where it belongs in the 70th week of Daniel, and they're going to discover, and we can appreciate and value how the Lord Jehovah explicitly promises specific provisions that will enable the little flock to go through that time of tremendous calamity and the tremendous horrors of that period of time. That's what Psalm 23 is all about. The first, by the way, Jehovah, his name Jehovah. Jehovah, by the way, means the Lord, okay? But when you talk about the Lord, he oftentimes connects a particular function or a characteristic or an activity or a quality to his name Jehovah. I've got, again, there's a list of 40 of them. Some of you are familiar with Jehovah Jireh. Jehovah Jireh, God or the Lord who provides. Okay, Psalms. Go to Exodus 34, by the way. You know, when the Lord talks about his name, go to Exodus chapter 34. You know, God says there in Psalms, "Thou hast magnified thy word above thy name." Okay. Names have extreme significance, all right? Names aren't just, in the Bible, names aren't given as a, just simply as a means of address. You know how God's always changing names? He changed Abram's name to what? Abraham. Why? I mean, there's a bunch of different names. Isaac, Israel. I mean, he changes their names. Names are not just formal means of addressing someone. Names in the Bible are intended to communicate a particular characteristic or a provision. Here is one easy example of the use of a name to communicate something specific. In Psalms chapter 34, if you notice there in verse 5, now remember, you know, Moses, he's asking the Lord to show him his glory and so on and so forth. In Exodus 34, verse 5, "And the Lord descended in the cloud and stood with him there and proclaimed the name of the Lord." But notice how. Verse 6, "And the Lord passed by before him and proclaimed, the Lord God, merciful and gracious, long-suffering and abundant in goodness and truth, keeping mercy for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin, and that will by no means clear the guilty, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children's children, unto the third and the fourth generation." So, when the Lord proclaims his name, he attaches with it something about his person. Who is he? What does he do? What are the expectations of his people? When God says, I am the Lord. I am something to you. I am something for you. And what Israel ultimately needs, obviously, don't they need a Jehovah God who is merciful? Don't they need a Jehovah God who is gracious, who is long-suffering, who is abundant in goodness, and so on and so forth? So you see, when the Lord starts talking about his name, and you know, we can go back to, remember when Moses asked, you know, when Israel starts asking me, who is this God? And they ask what his name is. Remember when Moses was asking God in the burning bush? He says, "What do I tell them? What do I tell them your name is?" And what did God say? "I am." But you've heard it before. I am what? It isn't just simply I exist. I am. And now you have these Jehovah names. I am the sword. I am the Most High. I am your defense. I am your Redeemer. I am your King. I am your Judge. I am forever. I save. I'm a provider. I'm glory. I'm jealous. I'm a sanctifier. I'm a creator. I'm this, and on. 40 different names in God's Word, in the Old Testament specifically, okay? And just let me say this. In the Gospels and in the Hebrew Epistles, the writers will actually go back and amplify and even highlight some of those Jehovah names, okay? So the name of God is critically important. And by the way, let's fast forward, you and I, today in the dispensation of the grace of God. I did not even indicate that the dispensation of grace is up here, right? It's not over here. It's not over here. That I deliberately excluded the dispensation of grace. Because if you remove the mystery, all you would have is Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Acts, and then you're right there in the book of Hebrews, okay? So this is a prophetic timeline. If we were to study Paul's epistles and study the names of God, you will find there are 10 specific grace titles. And those grace titles, again, communicate some very specific qualities, characteristics, and provisions that God has for you and for me today. For example, He is the God of how much comfort? All what? Comfort. You know, we're supposed to know God today as the God of all comfort. He's the God of love. He's the God of hope. There's 10 of them, okay? So we know God in an important way via the titles that He's given to us, okay? Going back to Psalms 23 now. So let's just sort of look at what Psalms 23 is doing. Psalms 23 is a song that the remnant is going to sing. It's a song of reliance. It's a song of joy. As the remnant actually relies upon and enjoys the specific provisions that His Jehovah character promises to give them as they go through the 70th week. Verse 1, the Lord is my shepherd. That's Jehovah Rohi. That's the title, Jehovah my shepherd. And this is considered one of the Jehovah compound names. He is a shepherd. Let me list very quickly the Jehovah functions in chapter 23. They're not titles, but for example, look there at verse 2. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me besides the still waters. There's so much we could, you know, verse 2. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. What is, you know, when a sheep, where, you know what he's saying? He maketh me, I lie down, where? My bed. You talk about, by the way, this is the function of Jehovah Shalom. Now, I know some of you know what Shalom means, right? Peace. You know what verse 2 promises the little flock? During the outbreak of just absolute wrath and terror and war and destruction and calamity, you know what the little flock, one of the promises that Jehovah makes to His little flock is, you're going to be at peace. You're going to be at peace, little flock. That doesn't mean all of Israel's at peace, by the way, but the little flock, because Jehovah is Jehovah Shalom, there, verse 2, they're going to be able to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me besides the what? The still waters. Now, during the trib, if you study the book of Revelation, you don't know how precious that promise is. Now, verse 3, He restoreth my soul. He restoreth my soul. Now, that is a function of Jehovah Rofeki, which means the Lord that heals. Not physical healing, mind you, but there is in verse 3, this promise of a spiritual restoration that members of the little flock are going to actually enjoy during that tribulational period. Now, verse 3 continues, he leadeth me in the paths of righteousness. Now, that is a function of Jehovah Tsidkenu. Now, it's spelled with a T. Oh, by the way, there are different spellings, Hebrew. Anyway, the Tsidkenu means the Lord my righteousness. And what verse 3, the latter half of verse 3, is promising is that same shepherd is also going to provide the provision of leading that little flock in the path of righteousness. And there's some verses all over about how God's going to actually lead them in that path of righteousness. Look at verse 4. Verse 4, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art, here we go, with me. That's a function of Jehovah Shema. That means the Lord is present. So in verse 4, the little flock, they look to their shepherd who functions as that great I am, the Lord, Jehovah, who is present. They're able to say in verse 4, he is what? He is with me. Now the end of verse 4, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. We're not even going to be able to get over there. Verse 5, thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine, what? Enemies. That's a function of Jehovah Nissi, which means the Lord my banner. The little flock, they're going to eat. And the enemies are going to witness something out there. And there was something that happened in the Old Testament. God did some really interesting... You know, ever wonder why God made Israel do some kind of really bizarre things? After crushing the Amalekites, God says, I want you to set up a table and I want you to eat. And the defeated captive Amalekites, you know what they're doing? They're watching. Now, why did God do that in the past? You know why? Because that is, you've heard, it's a dress rehearsal of what's going to happen. Listen, you know what God's going to do in that midst, well, towards the end of the 70th week, when the valley of the shadow of death, when the Gentiles congregate for the purpose of seeking the extermination of that faithful remnant, you know what God says? He says, you go ahead, set up some tables there and let them watch. I mean, again, Jehovah my Nissi, Jehovah my what? My banner. And then verse 5, thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Now, this is a highly significant verse. You know what? What does oil represent in Scripture? The Holy Spirit. You know what verse 5 is talking about? Thou anointest my head. That is a function of Jehovah Magadish, which means the Lord my sanctifier. The idea of thou anointest my head with oil, that is a figure of the anointing, sanctifying ministry of God, the Holy Spirit, again, towards that end of that tribulational period. So you have the Jehovah title, he's my shepherd, but he's my peace. He's my healer. He's the one who's going to lead me in righteousness. He's the one who's going to provide. He's the one who's going to be my sanctifier. And then at the very end of that tribulational period, verse 6, surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my... That's resurrection life. That's resurrection life. And what you find, that remnant, they're gonna gain entry into that millennial reign, and they're going to enjoy the goodness and mercy of Almighty God. For the rest of their lives, I will dwell in the house of the Lord for how long? Forever. The house of the Lord. Now, the house of the Lord is not New Jerusalem. And you know, in the book of Revelation, that's a horrible color. You know, New Jerusalem comes down at the very end, right? And it's that city of Almighty God and the beautiful, the 12, this beautiful, beautiful, glorious cities, you know, and they got the dimensions and so on and so forth. But there is a house inside of that city. And what the Lord is promising those members of that little flock that have to endure that entire period. You know that they're the ones. Revelation says, for example, that God says, I'm going to give you white robes and I'm going to give you a name and you're going to be a pillar in my temple. There's something we should always kind of understand here. In the book of Exodus, Israel was to be a nation of what? Priests. They lost it. Israel forfeited that opportunity to be a nation of priests. So now, during the earthly ministry of Jesus Christ and the shepherd now, he's calling them out and he's going to lead them out of the sheepfold. Those members of the little flock, they're the ones that are given the promise of being a royal priesthood. But guess what happens? You have the crucifixion, you have the resurrection, and then Hebrews to Revelation, Hebrews will 1 John will say something about this. All of a sudden now, you have that promise extended to those who endure, those who make it through. They're the ones that are promised participation in that temple, in that specific locale, within the New Jerusalem, the house of the Lord forever. So it's kind of interesting. What God tried to do in the past, it becomes narrowed. It becomes more, it identifies a more specific group of people until finally we see the ultimate recipients, the ones that go through that tribulational period. They're the ones that are going to dwell in the house of the Lord forever. That's a pretty good comfort if you're a Jew. If you're going through that tribulational period, I hope, if anything, and time's already gone, this chapter has no application for you or for me today. We don't turn to Jehovah anything. We don't know God as Jehovah today. And I know people, we know God in a very different way, all right? I think we're just going to have to stop here because I guess we'll just call that introduction, all right? There's so much about God being the shepherd. I'll just say this. Not once is Jesus Christ ever called our shepherd today. Not once. Not once is the church, the body of Christ, ever called the sheep. We're not called God's sheep at all. I mean, can somebody quote Matthew chapter 10 or Matthew chapter 15? The Lord Jesus Christ. Tell you what, two verses, we're done. Go to John chapter 10 and then Matthew chapter 10, all right? John 10, Matthew 10, okay? And I know some people all of a sudden they get all fired. How in the world can you say Jesus is not our shepherd? Well, we got to, at least that's, the verses do not teach that we are the sheep and Jesus Christ is our shepherd today. In John chapter 10, the Lord Jesus Christ, He actually is going to demonstrate that he is the fulfillment of passages in Isaiah, Jeremiah, and Ezekiel, okay? Ezekiel chapter 34 especially. In Ezekiel 34, there is a wealth of detail about the shepherd, okay? So what does the Lord Jesus do in John chapter 10? He's telling the nation, I'm the Messiah shepherd. I am the one that the Old Testament prophets have been talking about. And he says there in John chapter 10, verse 11, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd giveth his life for the who? For the sheep. Go to Matthew chapter 10. Matthew chapter 10. And verse 6. Matthew 10, verse 6. But go rather to the lost sheep of the house of who? The house of Israel. Listen, Psalms 23 actually tells us who is promised the shepherd. It is a group of sheep, But the Bible clearly already identified who the sheep are. The sheep in Scripture has always been and forever will be the nation of Israel. So right off the bat, Psalms 23 can't be an application for anybody today, all right? We're going to stop because time is absolutely gone. Father, we do thank you for your word. We thank you, Lord, that we can gain understanding and insight. We thank you that by applying that important principle of right division, we don't have to confuse our identity with Old Testament passages. Certainly, we aren't being robbed of anything, but rather may we be careful. May we handle the word of God with tremendous care. And may we handle it with tremendous accuracy. And may we just see where passages of Scripture fit in your purpose and program. And may we rejoice in how it is you work yourself out through those promises and provisions. We thank you, Father, for the hope that we have and the assurance that you give to us through the pen of your spokesman today, the pen of the Apostle Paul. And may we just glory in all that you promise us through the person of your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. And we pray it, of course, in his name. Amen.